This is a toothpick, but not just any toothpick. It's equipped with the latest DJI O4, weighs just 76 grams, and still delivers 10 kilometers of range with 4K at 60 FPS. Sounds perfect, right? Well, this build wasn't easy. It's designed for the previous DJI O3, and I made a dumb mistake, and I did it twice. The O4 is fragile, and if you don't reinforce it properly, things can break fast, but I'll show you exactly how to build, configure, and fly it, so you can avoid my mistakes. First of all, TuneRC provided me with this kit for free. I'm not being paid, and my opinion is completely my own. Alright, before we send this thing ripping through the air, we gotta start with the basics. The frame. This is the TuneRC 3.5-inch frame, built for AIO stacks with a 25mm mounting pattern. And the best part, it comes in a kit at an insane price. But more on that later. The arms? They're thick and feel super sturdy, definitely built to take a hit. Now, here's the catch. This kit was actually designed for a DJI O3 build. Since we're using the newer O4 Lite, some parts won't fit. So, we'll have to swap out a few components and print new ones for the O4. Alright, let's get to work. I've always wanted to build a toothpick. These little quads are perfectly balanced, with everything centered for a super responsive feel, in theory. But does it actually work? Stick around for my final thoughts and flight footage. First up, the carbon arms. They're locked in place with two screws, one short, one long. The long ones? That's where the electronics will go later. TuneRC actually recommends using Loctite for the nuts, but honestly, I didn't use any, and they still held up just fine. We have to skip the nuts for the long screws here. You'll find out why later. Next, the motors. Before mounting them, let's take a moment to appreciate just how tiny these things are. 1104, 3600 kV, and only 5.2 grams each. That's lighter than a single AA battery. Gotta be honest, I was a little skeptical. Tiny motors like these, can they really deliver? We'll find out. They come neatly packed, and each one includes mounting screws, which, by the way, are really small. So if you drop one, good luck finding it. Alright, let's get one of these installed. First, we screw in 4 bolts. Then, we twist the wires together, not just for looks, but to reduce electrical noise and keep things tidy. We feed them through the heat shrink tubing, which, in my opinion, just looks way cleaner than zip ties or tape. One down and 3 to go. Alright, I made a really dumb mistake, like, really dumb. The kind of mistake you get warned about everywhere, every time. And somehow, I still did it, twice. So, what happened? When I screwed in the motors, the bolts were just a little too long, and yeah, they went straight into the windings, completely shredded them. These motor wires are thin, and I wrecked 2 of them before I even realized what was happening. And why? Because I grabbed the wrong screws. Instead of using the ones for mounting the motors, I accidentally used the prop screws. I could have left this out of the video, pretended it never happened. But hey, nobody's perfect. Mistakes happen. And this one? Yeah, I won't be making it again. Luckily, TuneRC includes 5 motors in the kit. If you're only half as clumsy as I am, you won't have to order replacements. But for now, I had to put the build on hold. Now, space is tight on a toothpick build. But honestly, cable management is pretty straightforward. Way easier than my other builds, where I had to plan every single wire route. The capacitor, though? Yeah, that took some trial and error. I had to reposition it multiple times before it finally fit, and you'll see why later, there's really only one way to mount it properly. When it comes to soldering, there are 3 things that'll make your life so much easier. High heat, thick tip, and lots of flux. Even if you're not a pro, you'll get solid results with these. Alright, the 30-inch capacitor are soldered up, the joints look solid, but man. This board was way trickier to solder than others I've used, especially the ground pad. Just eats heat, took way longer than expected to get a good connection. But in the end, everything's secure, and we're ready for the next step. One more thing, make sure your flight controller isn't touching the frame. And definitely don't let the O4 air unit and FC make contact. That's a fast track to a short circuit, and trust me, you don't want that. So, here's the deal. This flight controller doesn't have a plug and play connector for the DJI O4 air unit. That means we have to modify the cable, remove some pins, shorten the wires, and manually solder everything up. The air unit needs power and a UART connection, so we're using UART1 on the FC. And don't forget, DX from the FC goes to RX on the air unit, and RX from the FC goes to TX on the air unit. Now, a quick heads up about the O4 light. It needs clean power, ideally between 2S and 3S. It's not super stable on 1S. To keep things simple, we're pulling power directly from the battery pads. We'll set everything up in Betaflight later. Next up, firmware update and binding. First, connect the air unit to your PC and update the firmware using DJI Assistant. Then, if you haven't already, update your goggles as well. Otherwise, the O4 won't show up in the status menu. Once everything's up to date, put the air unit into binding mode by holding the bind button until the LED starts flashing red. Now, hold the power button on the goggles until you hear a series of short beeps. And finally, double check that there's enough space between the FC and air unit. You do not want these touching, otherwise you're asking for a short circuit. Clean wiring isn't just about looks, it's about reliability. First up, motor cables. We cut them down to size, but not too short. A little slack helps prevent strain on the solder joints. Next, we strip the insulation. Quick and easy. Then, it's time to solder. Lots of heat, plenty of flux. That's the secret to strong, lasting connections. And don't stress about motor direction just yet. Betaflight lets us fix that later. It's all about that perfect, shiny ball. Nothing too dull, just that smooth, glossy finish. You want those wires fully covered, not a single strand left exposed. And the pad on the board? It needs to be fully utilized, making that solid connection. Now, the receiver. This one's new to me. It's from DFR, a 2.4 GHz Express LRS receiver. I've never tested it before, so I'm curious to see how it performs. Wiring it up is simple. Just connect TX to RX and RX to TX. If you get this wrong, your radio won't connect. Placing it under the flight controller is not an option because the battery strap gets in the way. Instead, we attach it to an arm and keep the antenna on a separate one for the best signal. The most frustrating part of any build, the configuration. Wiring things up? Easy. But making it all actually work? That's where things get tricky. But don't worry, I'll walk you through the essentials, including a quick and dirty PID tune that I use on all my fresh builds. First up, ELR setup. It's actually pretty painless if you're using the stock firmware. Just power up the receiver, wait for the rapid blinking, hop onto its Wi-Fi, and enter your binding phrase. Done. Simple. No flashing, no headaches. Next, Betaflight setup. Go into the presets tab, find the ELR's preset that matches your radio, and select it. One click, that's it. Just don't forget to set the correct UART. Otherwise, you'll be wondering why nothing's working. Now let's make sure Betaflight knows which way the flight controller is facing. Flip the quad around. Does the on-screen model match your real-life movements? If yes, perfect. If no, you might need to tweak the yaw offset, especially if your FC is mounted differently than the gyro arrow printed on the board. And now, the motors. Do they spin the right way? Probably not. I use a small piece of tape on the bell to make the rotation super obvious. If they're spinning the wrong way compared to the direction shown in Betaflight's motor diagram, just hop into the motor wizard and reverse them. Before we can even think about flying, we need to set up some switches on the radio. The three I always map first, arming, because, well, you kinda need that to fly, beeper, to find the quad, and crash flip to flip it around. And finally, the PID tune. No deep dives, no endless tweaking, just the essentials. First, enable D-Shot and RPM filtering. Second, enter your motor's magnet count. Not sure? Just count them. Third, use the master multiplier slider. I usually bump it up to 1.3 max for the first flight. Oh, and before we wrap up, I'll give you a quick look at my rates. Alright, time to reinforce the O4, because let's be real, it's light, but it's also crazy fragile. One bad crash, and boom, the UFL connector snaps off, or the camera plug breaks. The leverage on that camera plug is way too high, so let's lock it down with some solid reinforcement. We're pushing glue into every weak spot, locking everything down so nothing comes loose in a crash. The UFL connector is getting extra support too. No weak links here. And now, the moment of truth. Did we do everything right? Does the canopy actually fit over the stack? This thing is tight, and trust me, handling the O4 feels like holding a raw egg. A quick but crucial detail, the camera cable must face upward. Mess that up, and your entire feed will be upside down. Also, don't crank down the canopy screws too much. You'll crush those soft silicone dampers. Now, let's get the O4 talking to the flight controller. The easiest way? Just use a preset. Search for it, select your UART, save it. Boom, done. Customize your OSD however you like from there. Next up, props. Seems easy, right? But get this wrong and you could toast your motors. Too long screws? Big mistake. Always double check before tightening. I'm sticking with Toon RC's recommended props for now, but who knows, maybe I'll experiment with different ones, or even swap motors altogether. By the way, this is why there's not much room for error with the capacitor. Alright, first things first, this thing is insanely light, like ridiculously light. And yet, with the DJI O4, we're still getting buttery smooth 4K at 60fps. That's just crazy. But not everything is perfect. The battery situation? Yeah, not great. It wobbles around, and that's just asking for trouble. You could fix it with countersunk screws, or better yet, 3D print a plate to create a flat mounting surface. Still, I love this build. I love toothpicks, and I really love the colors. This yellow TPU just pops. And here's a big win, the Toon RC kit. For just $99, you get the frame, 5 motors, and an AIO stack. That's a steal. Now, so far, my O4 is holding up, but how much abuse can it really take? That's what I'm curious about. So, how does it fly? What's it actually for? Well, it's not built for hardcore bando bashing. But for park and open field freestyle? Perfect. There's no space for a dedicated action cam, but that's not the point. This quad is all about pure fun, and with its low weight and solid balance, it's seriously agile. As for the O4 light footage, honestly, it's really good. For just over $100, you're getting some insanely clean shots. But this video isn't about the O4, it's about this quad. Who's it for? Pretty much anyone looking for a fast, nimble park flyer. It's fun, it's light, it's great for cruising and freestyle. Would an O3 be too heavy? Probably. Could the motors use a little more punch? Maybe. I'll be testing some different props to see if we can squeeze out a little more performance. And if you want to see more builds, check this out. See you in the next video.